From plastic eating shrimps, to a crab who uses an anemone as a house, all the way to a half squid, half octopus situation, we are diving back into the dark, icy waters of the deep sea. Hey, what is up, life's biggest questions fam? I am your host today, Olivia Kozlowski, and today we are diving into part 3 of the top 10 weirdest things found in the Mariana Trench. Let's get right into it. Starting off in our number 10 spot, we have the deep sea hermit crab. Okay, so we've all seen or at least heard of a hermit crab before. You know, those little crabs that find their homes in empty shells to protect their fragile exoskeletons. Well, those might not be the weirdest things out there, but their deep sea counterparts really up the ante in terms of the bizarre. Instead of carrying around the empty shells like the shallow hermit crabs do, the deep sea ones instead use sea anemones, and it is truly a strange looking relationship.
This anemone actually replaces the sort of shell which pagurids usually house themselves in. They look like they're missing
While it looks like these deep sea hermit crabs are missing a pair of legs, they've actually just adapted in a way where they are used to hold the anemone in place. I'm not gonna lie, these guys really appear like a gross sea spider that I never want to have to encounter. In our number 9 spot today, we have a plastic bag. When diving to the deepest point on Earth, one probably doesn't expect to find human trash, but unfortunately, here we are. In 2019, Victor Vescovo took a dive down to the Challenger Deep, which is the deepest part of the Mariana Trench. Getting there is an incredible feat and a major move for science, and Victor, along with finding a ton of new information and even some new species, was also rewarded with a reminder of the plague of plastic pollution. While discovering a new type of crustacean, Victor also found a plastic bag just hanging out at the bottom of the ocean. How great! While this certainly wasn't the best part of the dive, that should not be a reason to diminish the incredible work they were able to do that day, and the fact that this was the deepest dive ever recorded. In our number 8 spot today, we have plastic crustaceans. Considering what we just talked about, this is one discovery that just may help us all out. A few years ago, there were little shrimp-like creatures found around 20,000 feet deep in the Mariana Trench. While a shrimp is not necessarily a creature that deserves a spot on this list, these guys are, and that is because of what researchers found in their bellies. As it turns out, these little creatures were eating plastic. More specifically, PET, which is a common plastic resin that is most commonly used in the fibers for clothing, packing food, and for plastic drinking bottles. It is kind of sad that we found a new species only to realize that before we found it, it had already found our plastic pollution, but researchers are hoping that this discovery brings more attention to how bad the pollution really is. In our number 7 spot today, we have Foraminifera. These guys are giant single-celled organisms that are kind of like oversized amoebas, and they can be found in the sediment on seabeds throughout the world. In 1995, however, when Japanese researchers were able to collect samples of sediment located in the Mariana Trench, they found 432 living ones. I know I just made these guys sound really large before, but I just mean large in terms of the single-celled organism world. They are still super tiny, and they are usually found with a hard outer shell, but not the ones in the trench. These guys have found a way to adapt by basically building their own shells from proteins, organic polymers, and even sand. The ones most commonly found in the Mariana Trench are called xenophyophores, and these guys use the fact that grains of sand are mostly made out of silicon dioxide, which is the main constituent of glass, to their advantage. They basically glue sand from ocean sediments, cast off shells, and microbial skeletons to make their own kind of pressure-proof shells. So I guess they're the engineers of the deep sea? In our number 6 spot today, we have immense pressure. Considering how I've talked about the extreme environment that exists in the Mariana Trench on every part of this video series, it only feels right to take a second to really dive into the amount of pressure that actually exists down there. On the surface of the ocean, we are sitting at a base of 1 atmospheric pressure. When you go just 10 meters down into the ocean, that number already doubles. Taking this knowledge and the fact that the Mariana Trench is 11,000 meters deep, it becomes quite clear that the pressure is going to build quite a bit. The pressure changes causes the air in your body to compress, and the deeper you go, the more dense the water becomes. These facts are easy to comprehend, but it can be quite difficult to really conceptualize what that means and just how deep the trench really is. 1 atmospheric pressure, which is what we are sitting at, is 1.013 bars, which is the unit used to measure pressure. In the depths of the Mariana Trench, that number skyrockets to 1,086 bars, which would be the equivalent of 100 elephants standing on you. Now I'm really starting to see why there have only been a few who've made the trip down to the Challenger Deep. In our number 5 spot today, we have barophilic bacteria. Since we just talked about the immense pressure that exists in the Mariana Trench, it only seems fair that we talk about something that thrives off of this extreme environment, and that is barophilic bacteria. This bacteria is characterized by its preference for an environment with greater pressure than atmospheric pressure, which of course makes the trench a perfect candidate for a home. These bacteria have been isolated from deep sea environments and found to grow rapidly at low temperatures and high pressures. This low temperature, high pressure combo that is found in the deep sea environment is usually the cause for the decrease of the fluidity of lipids, as well as the depression of the function of biological membranes. But this doesn't happen in this bacteria, which has led to the theory that they must have some sort of mechanism that allows their lipids to adapt to their extreme environment. Aside from their superpower, these bacteria help to support life by being a source of carbon for the deep sea animals that end up ingesting them. In our number 4 spot today, we have the telescope octopus. These guys get their name from their unique protruding eyes, which allows them to have better peripheral vision so that they can see both their prey as well as their predators better. These creepy eyes also have the ability to rotate, which sounds absolutely disgusting and very painful, but I'm sure it's totally fine for them. Many species of octopus like to hang out on or around the seafloor, but these guys prefer to just float or dangle in the deepest currents of the ocean. Another thing that is weird about the telescope octopus compared to other octopuses is how most like to swim horizontally, but the telescope octopus prefers to swim vertically. It's not quite clear why, but it is thought that this might be so that it is harder for predators to see their shape. The telescope octopus has nearly transparent skin, and in between all of its 8 tentacles, there is a delicate webbing that makes it look like the ghost of the deep sea. In our number 3 spot today, we have the frogfish. Frogfish may be weird to look at, but they are masters of disguise. They are quite sedentary fish and usually find their home 1,000 feet or 300 meters deep in the ocean, right on the seafloor. The reason these guys are so good at disguising themselves is because their colors vary greatly, and they have the ability to change colors in order to adapt to their environment, which lets them blend in super easily. The color changing process can take anywhere from a few days to a few weeks, so they aren't quite as fast as, say, a chameleon, but still, I don't have that kind of power, so I'm gonna go ahead and call their little skill pretty impressive. These guys also have a little modified fin on their head that resembles a fishing rod with bait. This helps lure in their unsuspecting prey who think they're going to get a nice tasty meal, only to quickly realize that they are about to become the meal. In our number 2 spot today, we have comb jellies. Comb jellies are gelatinous creatures that are named for their unique plates of fused cilia, which are called combs. These combs help the jelly move through the water like boat oars, and while other microscopic organisms also have this sort of mechanism, comb jellies are the largest animal with this feature. These combs are also part of the reason that comb jellies are so gorgeous to look at. Rather than bioluminescence, the rainbow light effect that can sometimes be seen on them is from light diffracting off of the combs in all different directions. Many comb jellies have one pair of tentacles, although they appear to have multiple, but that is just caused by their tentacles branching out. These tentacles are used to help them hunt like a sort of fishing line. Aside from this, these jellies don't sting, which is always a good thing, not that I'm planning on heading into the deep sea anytime soon. In terms of today's list, I'd say that these are one of the less creepy creatures we've got going on. In our number 1 spot today, we have the vampire squid. The vampire squid is the last surviving member of its order, and it has similarities with both the squid as well as the octopus, which might make it a contender for the most threatening animal on today's list. Like the Dumbo octopus from part 1, this guy has little ear-like fins that help it propel itself through the water, but unlike the Dumbo octopus, it isn't small and cute and sweet looking. Like a jellyfish, the vampire squid has a gelatinous body that helps it move quicker through the depths of the sea. The vampire squid is covered in light producing organs called photophores, which they are able to use in a way that produces disorienting flashes so as to confuse their prey. While the vampire squid doesn't have ink, it does have the ability, when in really dangerous situations, to shoot out a bioluminescent mucus at whatever is attacking it. Also, the squid is able to regenerate its arms. So I think this all goes to say that if you were in a fight with a vampire squid, I really hope you came prepared, because he sure did. Alright guys, that has been our list for today. Thank you so much for checking it out. Don't forget to hit that thumbs up button if you enjoyed today's video, and subscribe. I've been your host today, Olivia Kozlowski, and I'll see you next time. Bye! Alright. Oh, what? No freaking intro? Definitely wrote one. I probably just didn't copy and paste it into the script. All right, we're freeballing this. Okay. What's in this script? Okay, cool. Okay, cool. Cool, 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 cool. Okay. These combs help the jelly move through the waters like boat oars, and while other microscopic